SBS wishes to advise that the following program may cause distress to members of the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Island communities. It may contain images or voices of deceased persons.
Welcome to Inside, I'm Jenny Brockie. Tonight, electricity prices, why our power bills are going up and whether anything can be done about it. Welcome everybody, good to have you all here. I'm just keen to get a sense of why people think electricity prices are going up at the moment. Hanson, why do you think they're going up?
I think the cost of actually producing electricity is going up. So I think the company is actually passing that cost along to the consumer.
So the cost of producing the electricity in the first place. What do other people think? Narina, why do you think the prices are going up?
Due to the increase in energy usage.
So just the usage?
Yes.
That's the main reason. Mark, what about you?
I'd say it's to change our behaviour, get us to use less electricity.
So you think it's being pushed up to just make everybody cut back?
Maybe that, and also with their infrastructure as well.
Okay, Matt, you've looked into this on behalf of consumers. Why are electricity prices going up?
Sure. Well, from a consumer point of view, the single biggest factor pushing up energy prices is infrastructure, and that's the networks which transport energy from the generator to your power point. So that's distribution, it's transmission. It's basically those poles and wires which bring the energy from where it is created to your home.
Okay, so it's the poles and the wires and the substations and things like that that are driving it. Is that all the price increase or most of it or what?
It's the majority of it. So, for example, I think the figure on price increases is something like one-third between around 2007 and 2010 in terms of how much retail prices have gone up. Within that, probably about two-thirds of it has been network costs. There's been other factors like wholesale electricity, which is actually the cost of generation. That's maybe been about one-fifth of that. There's other factors like retailers. So that's the people who consumers are actually familiar with, the name that's on your bill. And there's a margin involved with that and also their cost of operating.
Okay, so just explain to us, because it's not easy to understand at a glance, how the system works. I mean, what are the elements of the system?
Yeah, look, you're right. It's not easy to understand at all. And for a consumer, the only part of that system that you're ever likely to have any contact with is the retailer. So that's the logo that's on your bill, when you open the mail, the person that you pay, basically, for your energy supply. It starts with the generators. So in the national electricity market, for example, which is all of Australia except Western Australia and the NT, there's about 200 large generators.
So things like power stations, coal-fired powered stations.
Exactly right. They're the ones who produce the energy. From them it goes into a transmission network, which is really the high voltage network. Then it goes into the distribution network. So that's the network that, if you like, crisscrosses the suburbs when you see the poles and wires.
So that's the poles and the wires.
Exactly, in your neighbourhood. That's what brings it to your door. Sitting right at the end of that is the retailer. So that's the brand names that people are familiar with, the people who you actually deal with. Their job is to buy that energy from the generators. They bundle it with the costs of transporting it. So they're actually paying those costs, if you like, to the transmission and the distribution networks. Then they charge you for it. And, of course, they knock on your door a lot.
They mark it. Which is going up all the time.
Well, this is exactly right. So we think from a consumer point of view, bills have gone up very steeply, particularly in about the last 3 years. We think excessively so. And there actually hasn't been enough scrutiny of why some of those price rises.
Okay, we're going to get on to why it's going up the way it is. But just so we're clear on that, that's a really good description in terms of that price bounces along the chain, presumably, from the generators. It bounces all the way along that chain. Andrew Reeves, you're the government regulator. Explain to us in simple terms how then pricing works. How is electricity priced?
Well, generally, there are those three parts. There's the cost of production. And in that sector, the price is set by the market. So generators bid and make offers to retailers. There's competition there, and the market itself will determine what those prices are. The costs of the transmission network and the distribution network, that is the poles and wires, prices for that are set by the Australian Energy Regulator under rules set out by the Australian Energy Markets Commission. And network costs are about half of a customer's total bill.
And you approve those costs, yeah?
We do. We receive proposals from the firm. we examine those proposals, and ultimately we make a decision on what the charges should be for the use of the networks.
OK. Now, is the current system at the moment working, do you think? Is it working well? Why are we seeing the big increases?
We're now getting to the end of the first 5 years of operation of a new set of rules. We've done a review, and we consider, an internal review, and we consider that the rules which were set up at a time when it was believed there was a need for a lot of investment in the network have been set too much in favour of the firms.
Which firms? Too much in favour of the poles and wires
and the transmission companies. We feel that it is time that the rules were re-examined by the Australian Energy Markets Commission for an outcome that gives a better balance of the needs of the firm for investment and the needs for consumers, such that consumers are only paying what is necessary for a reliable supply.
OK, so what, over-investment in this infrastructure? Or you think the rules, when you say you think the rules favour those networks, how do they favour them? What does that mean?
The rules do encourage the businesses to invest heavily in the network. The rules also restrict the way the regulator can look at the proposals put forward by the firms. And we feel that if we had better tools to be able to challenge those proposals, we get an outcome that was more balanced in favour of the consumers.
OK, that's interesting. So you don't trust the proposals you're getting? Is that the bottom line?
Well, our job is to challenge the proposals that we get. And we do that. And we certainly haven't accepted what's been put in front of us. In broad terms, we've reduced the expenditure that's been proposed by about 10%. Nevertheless, the proposals we've had in front of us have been significantly above the expenditure that the firms have previously made.
So how does that happen then? How do those prices go up?
Well, after the firm puts in the proposal, we will bring in our own advisors, examine those, and we can make adjustments. But the rules limit the way we can approach that, and they limit how much adjustment we can actually make to the proposals.
So you want the rules changed?
Yes, we believe that it is timely for the rules to be changed.
All right, George, you're in charge of one of these networks, the poles and wire networks, one of the biggest ones in the country. Are you part of the problem? Are you investing too much in infrastructure?
We don't believe so. I mean, we invest what's needed to meet peak demand and to replace ageing assets. The fact is that our networks were largely built in the 60s and 70s. They're now 40 or 50 years old. A lot of the equipment is aged and needs to be replaced. That's a cyclic factor, and that's one of the reasons that bills are increasing so much now. The other thing that's driving network infrastructure investment is peak demand.
What is peak demand?
Peak demand,
we hear about this all the time. What is it?
Is when everybody turns their switch on at the same time, and it's generally on a hot day in the evening or on a cold night where people put their heaters on, put their air conditioners on, they all do it at the same time, and the network has to be there to meet the demand of everybody that throws a switch. So that's what drives the network, the size of the infrastructure, if you like. And electricity networks are not like road networks, where if you don't build enough capacity, then all the traffic slows down and people might make another choice, get public transport, for example. If you can't meet peak demand, an electricity system will simply stop.
Do you build a system that can cope with this peak demand, even if the peak demand is only for, you know, a certain number of hours a year or a certain number of days? You have to have a system that can cope with a huge demand for electricity, even though it might not be used all the time.
That's right. About 15% of our system, or about $12 billion, sits there for 100 hours of the year, 4 days. And that's the problem with peak demand. And I agree with Andrew to a point that the rules need to be changed. But I think they need to be changed so that peak demand is managed better.
All right. Chris Dunstan, you've researched the managing of peak demand. That's your thing. Just explain to us a little bit more about how it drives up prices, and to what extent do you think it's responsible for the increases? You know, where do you see the issue with the increases we're getting at the moment?
Jenny, as George said, in terms of the network business, is that peak demand is the major driver because you need to build for that. That's also true in the generation sector for power stations, so that if we're only building a power station that is being used for a few hours a year for that absolute peak demand, usually in the middle of a hot summer or on a cold winter's night, then the cost of recovering
that expenditure or that investment in the power station is very high. And so it's like building a second harbour bridge and having to pay for it.
But what's the alternative to that?
Well, there are alternatives. The traditional model of our electricity system has been to forecast what the peak demand will be and then build enough power stations and enough networks to make sure that we can meet it. And that's what's called supply-side management, building more supply to meet demand. The alternative is demand management. That is finding ways to reduce the demand for electricity by encouraging people to be more efficient, by offering incentives for businesses to reduce their consumption at peak demand, offering incentives, offering rebates, information, engaging the community.
OK, Roman, what do you think about this? You represent the big energy users, companies that are big energy users. How much of our power increases do you think are down to the spending on infrastructure and peak demand and so on? I mean, where do you think the problem lies?
In recent years, it's undoubted that the majority of the increases have been due to the need to spend more on infrastructure. We've done some analysis of the reasons behind that, and what that analysis shows unequivocally is confirming what Andrew said about the need to change the rules. The rules at the moment are, as Andrew says, definitely promoting higher levels of expenditure, and that leads through to higher prices.
Does that mean people like George make more money? George?
We only spend what we need to spend to meet demand, because if we don't meet the demand, what will happen is, example, what happened in Sydney at Enmore, in a hot spell we had in February, we had old cables failed and tens of thousands of people were blacked out on very hot days, couldn't use their air conditioners. So there's not an option not to replace old assets, and there is no option but to meet peak demand.
OK, what do people think about that? Chris,
Well, there's a number of drivers of the investment. Replacing assets is part of it, but it's only part of it. That increasing peak demand is a big driver for investment. So if we can find ways to reduce that peak demand, then we don't need to spend as much on infrastructure, and we can instead spend money on helping people save
energy. Roman, did you want to say something else?
I did. The analysis that we did shows quite clearly that when you compare these businesses, when you benchmark them one against another, and that's a very important concept because we're dealing with monopoly businesses here, so it's not like buying a car where we can go down to one dealer, another dealer, one brand, another dealer, and compare, and we do our own benchmarking. In the case of these monopolies, we're very reliant on the regulator to do that benchmarking and to ensure that what people are paying is only the efficient costs, and that's passed through in terms of prices that are efficient. What Andrew has said is that that's not happening at the moment, and the analysis that we did shows that's not happening, and it particularly shows that in government-owned distributors, you get much higher levels of expenditure, much higher levels of inefficiency than you get in private
ones.
Essentially because there's a couple of reasons for this, and it's going to get a little bit complicated here, I'm afraid. But
well, it's to do with borrowing, as I understand it, as well, isn't it? Borrowing at lower rates and so on?
Yes. One reason is that the government-owned businesses, because they're government-owned, can get access to cheaper funds, basically, for example, cheaper debt, because they do that through their treasury corporations. In the case of privately owned ones, they have to go to the market, basically. But the regulator provides these businesses with the same rate of return. It doesn't matter whether they're government-owned or whether they're privately owned. So there's a windfall there that particularly goes to the government-owned ones.
OK, George, why are you laughing about the idea of a windfall?
Guess it's not surprising,
you're spending $8 billion, you're in the middle of an $8 billion spend on infrastructure at the moment. Are you overspending on infrastructure?
No, we certainly don't overspend, and I think the AER actually cut our capital budget or our capital allowances, and we've managed to work within that. We're very conscious of costs passed through to our customers, and we try to spend less than the allocated budgeted amount so that in the next period less cost is passed on. But can I just make a point about government and private? The rules that the AER follows to benchmark are independent of ownership. Their job is to benchmark the most efficient enterprise. It doesn't matter whether it's government or private. When that frontier is established, the regulator sets the price at that frontier. Customers shouldn't pay for inefficient enterprises, and it doesn't matter. The ownership in that case doesn't matter, because the frontier, the efficient frontier, the benchmarking, is what should happen.
So are you happy about the idea of Andrew changing the rules then?
I'm happy about changing the rules about managing peak demand. I don't see a need to change the rules in terms of the benchmarking that the AR does. I think they have sufficient power now. If you look at all the appeals that have gone on to the Australian Competition Tribunal, the appeal body in this process, the only cases where the appeal body has upheld the case of the utility as opposed to the AR has been in a case of error. So you find that where there has been error, then certainly the determinations have been overturned.
So this is about pricing you're talking about?
This is about pricing, yeah. And this is a question of whether the AER has enough power.
Okay.
I would argue they have enough power to substitute.
Enough power, Andrew?
I can respond to a couple of points there. The first, George is right in that the tribunal has to establish that there has been an error. But we're dealing here with a new set of rules, and quite a bit of this is interpretation of the rules. Here, the tribunal has interpreted the rules and applied the rules differently to how we've seen it.
OK, we're getting a bit technical here.
Let me come back to the other point, though, about the private ownership and government ownership. We do have a regime that's a one-size-fits-all, and the price outcome should be the same, whether it's a private owner or a government owner. In that case, we will allow the government firms the private owner's cost of capital. But by the same token, we want to be able to apply to the government firms the private sector's levels of efficiency. And to do that, we need to be able to apply benchmarking, and we don't at the moment have the tools to be able to do that properly.
OK, all right. We're going to have to go to a break, and in a moment we're going to talk a little bit more about the details about bringing the prices down and also how one remote community with limited power is managing to keep its lights on. That's next on Insight. Tonight we're looking at what can be done to stop our rising energy bills. We ploughed our way through the current system before the break. I want to get on to some other things now, but David Mills, I'm just interested in your perspective on all of this, because you've just come back from California after selling your solar thermal business to a French company. What do you think coming back to Australia of the way we're dealing with our energy needs right now?
Well, it's obviously tumultuous, I would say, at this moment, but it was also in the United States. And in California, they have the added feature of having a very, very strong renewables program coming in at the same time. So strong that it has such government support, the amount of renewable target for 2020 has been raised to 33%. 33% of electricity will be produced by renewables.
Lot more than our target.
That's a lot more than our target or anything like what the federal government is putting forward either. And in spite of that, there was no price consciousness. In fact, there was very, very strong public support for that move.
Price is high over there?
I would say prices here are now higher, but probably George would know that better than I. I think we were talking about around 15 or 20 cents a kilowatt hour over there, and I think our peak prices are now around 40.
What are our peak prices at the moment, Andrew?
Well, for retail, I meant.
Yeah, the typical retail prices would run in the low 20s, generally around Australia.
Okay.
Well, I received a notice yesterday at 48 cents as a peak.
For peak prices.
That's right.
For peak prices, yeah. Okay. All right, let's look at the way some other communities are dealing with this right now. And Phyllis, I want to ask you about your community in remote Arnhem Land. Tell us how you get your power now.
Before?
No, now. How do you get it now? Yeah.
Okay. So now that we are living with the solar power.
Okay, so solar panels?
Solar panels that's connected to our houses and runs the power.
Okay, and there's a limit, isn't there, to how much power is available at any given time. How do you know how much power you're using so that you can avoid having blackouts?
Each house has a different limit of the power. So each house have to have the own load of the power, because we're all living in that solar power.
And you've got a little box?
Yes, we've got a little box there. it shows us the limits of the power, how much we have the power.
How much you're using?
How much power that we're using in our houses, each houses.
Okay. And do you check that all the time to see how it's going?
Yes, we do.
And what does that mean in terms of what you do? Do you turn off lights if it looks like it's not too good or...?
Well, it depends on the power because it shows on the colour of the power.
Okay, we've got a picture of it here, yeah?
Yeah.
Mm. All right, so it shows when...
When all those green lights are on, that's totally we have the full power.
Okay. And when they go off, you know that it's going. Okay, Tig, tell us about this, because you're from Bushlight, which is a not-for-profit that's funded by the government. You installed this system, the solar system. Tell us how you're getting remote communities to use less power.
Sure. I mean, one of the features, obviously, of a solar system is that there's always going to be a limited amount of power that you can get from it. So we've got to work within those limits, and we have to work with the communities to help them work within those limits as well. So
and how do you do that?
We've got to... We do it two ways, I guess. We've got a really extensive consultation program. So we might work with a community for 6 months before any hardware goes into that community at all. And we have this long discussion about energy and where it comes from and how it gets consumed. So there's a big consultation process so that people, like the people in Phyllis's community, become really informed about energy and how different appliances use energy differently. So we do that. So there's a lot of information that we provide to people. And then we use technology. So the box that you saw backs up, I guess, all of that education work that we do with communities. So the people in each house have a sense of how much energy they need in a day, and we establish what we call an energy budget, and that's actually then programmed into that box that you saw, and each house has its own energy budget, which actually helps people. I guess the important thing that it really does is it gives people instantaneous feedback about how much energy they're using and how much energy they've got left for the day. And that's a really big difference between the houses connected up to these systems and the house that I live in, where I've got really no idea.
I'd like one of those.
Yeah,
actually, at home, it'd be good to have one of those.
Well, that's one of the interesting things about it, that we set it up specifically for this purpose. And then, you know, as people start to see that, they kind of go, that's really intuitive. That actually makes a lot of sense, and it gives us feedback that you just don't normally get in a suburban house.
Mm. Phyllis, is it working? I mean, are you using less power, do you think, than you used to?
Well, with the generator...
Which you had before.
Which we had before was our biggest problem. But now, because we have the solar panel setting up for us, and now it saves a lot.
Okay. You used to run on this diesel generator, power on the diesel. How did you get it? And how much did it cost?
Well,
how did you get the diesel to the remote community?
Yeah, we're looking at the central community place, like Elko Island. That's where we're getting the fuel from. And we're looking at the both on the cost and the airfare cost.
So you'd have to catch a plane to go and get the diesel to bring it back to the community.
Yeah. And it's cost a lot of money on the fuel and on the airfares.
Mm. Tig, how much does all this cost, though? And it must be heavily subsidised, yeah?
It is, yeah, it is. We wouldn't be able to do this without support from the government, obviously. The thing about solar is that it's very expensive up front, so that it's got very high capital costs. So a system like the one in Phyllis's community might cost around $400,000, and maybe more, depending on how remote it is. But I guess the great thing about solar is that in comparison to a diesel generator, which was the system before, it becomes very cheap after only a fairly short number of years. So maybe after about 5 or 6 years, if you compared it to the cost of, say, trying to generate power with a diesel generator, you're already in front. And a solar system like the one at Matamata has got a 20-year life expectancy. So high capital costs, but very low operating
costs.
But
you wouldn't be doing it without a big subsidy from the government. It just wouldn't be viable.
Absolutely not.
Yeah, okay. Matthew Wright, I know that you're from a renewable energy think tank. You're also from Victoria, which has smart meters, which are a kind of a version of this, of being able to register how you're using power. How do they compare to that?
Well, unfortunately, the Victorian ones are pretty basic. They went for the base model and it doesn't offer any feedback to the users as standard, and it doesn't have the ability to be remotely addressed by the network to curtail supplies other than the main supply and the off-peak hot water. So very basic system. In fact, I think what they tried to achieve was just to do the meter reader out of a job. So.
Okay, but does it tell a consumer how they're using power?
Not the option that gets put on your property. You can buy an interface that gets plugged into that, but I don't believe many Victorians will take up that option.
Okay. I mean, how do people feel about this? Would you like to have systems that showed you how you used your power, Hanson?
Very much like to know on a week-to-week basis, I suppose, not maybe not day-to-day, about how much my bill is going to be.
Well, I think that the consumers in Victoria don't even know that's an option. So they've been lumbered with the smart meter. The trucks come around, put it on their property, and they don't know anything about it, really. All it's done is given this computer-controlled remote access to read the meter, and it hasn't really provided any benefits to the consumers, and the consumers are paying for it.
OK. George, I know your company is looking at smart grids as opposed to smart meters. What are they? Tell us how smart grids work.
Well, smart grids is applying internet-based technologies and communications to the management of the grid itself to make the grid more reliable and more efficient, finding out where faults are, for example, putting sensors onto the system so that you know what's happening on the system.
And how does a smart grid deal with something like peak demand?
Well, you can have, in combination with consumer enablement, with communicating meters, the grid can communicate with a customer and give them pricing signals which are technology enabled to give them, for example, on a hot day, give them the option of cutting power down and giving them financial incentive to do that, for example.
Okay, so what, you get a flashing red light saying you're spending a fortune?
Or you get a signal on your iPhone, or flashing red light on whatever. There's a number of communication methods are available.
And there's also the idea of the grid actually determining when to turn your power off.
By permission, though. The important thing here is, and I think that's a very important point, that only consumers will decide how they use power. But in return for a financial incentive, they could give a grid company permission to manage their load.
And which would mean what? It would mean if you were in an office block and it was air-conditioned, or say this studio and it's air-conditioned, what, you'd pull the power at a certain point and leave it?
The way it would work is that air conditioning is a good example. You could take an area and cycle air conditioners so that you can turn off the compressor, which is the element that takes the most power, turn off, say, every second one, and let the fan run for half an hour. The household would see very little difference in comfort levels, but the system would have a reduction in load. That's one example that you could use with technology.
OK. Chris, what do you think about some of these options? I mean, are they good ways of...
Absolutely.
Getting our bills down?
No, what George is describing is exactly the type of things that we need to be seeing more of. And that's useful in terms of reducing peak demand. But we also need to have programs that help people to save energy, to promote ways in which we can use our energy more efficiently. And I think one of the challenges is for a company like George's, at Ausgrid, is that the incentives need to be there not just for the consumer, but for the company to provide those incentives. The way it's set up at the moment, we have a situation where the company can actually lose money if people use less electricity.
Yeah, well, that's what I was going to ask you, George. Is it in your company's interest for us to all use more power? Because you make, you know, and the retailers, because basically they make more money.
No, it's not in our interests. And we don't sell the energy. We provide an energised connection. And our costs are all about managing the peak. The peak determines how much infrastructure we have. So whatever infrastructure we have has to be paid for in one way or another. So even now we've got falling volumes, but prices are still going up because the peak's still going up.
Mm. Yeah, Matthew?
Basically, you make your money on everybody turning more and more air conditioners on, then you can go and get a new price determination for a whole lot of extra infrastructure to be built, which you can mark up, so you can grow your business by building more poles and wires, more substations, more everything to service that peak demand. It's not in your interest for people not to go and install air conditioners or to use them less. It's in your interest, your business, to install more physical assets so that you can make more money.
Okay, so what's the alternative to that though, Matthew? So
the alternative for that is a programmed energy efficiency program, which is to go around and to mine for energy efficiency. So to move to a services-based model where, in fact, we actually sell, say, warmth for a home or comfort for a home, not electrons for driving an electric heater or gas for a heater. You actually sell comfort in a home.
And so then, what, George would be selling double glazing as well as
That's right. So the retailer or someone in that sphere would actually sell that level of comfort. And that way they could actually think, oh, it's cheaper for us to go and find comfort by not sending the power down the line and just to continue to charge you and maybe even pass some savings on to you as a consumer. And that's a different model that's being done
around the world. That's a major shift in the system compared to the way it is now, yeah?
It's a big shift, but it's a much more efficient one and one that will create energy security for Australian families.
OK, George, how would you feel about a shift like that?
Look, I would generally agree that the incentives do need to be changed. The incentives ought to be on network businesses to manage demand better and promote energy efficiency. I don't agree that the incentives now are to sell more energy, but I do agree that there is no incentive to manage energy demand better or to promote energy efficiency.
And where should that incentive come from?
Well, in a regulated business, it has to come from the regulator. That's why the rules need to be changed.
OK, and Andrew, would you like a system like we've just heard about where the whole system was kind of turned around so that there was an incentive for energy efficiency?
There's probably a middle ground which you would need to go through towards that sort of model. But yes, the rules aren't adequate to give enough incentives for management of demand and for energy efficiency.
OK, and this all matters, folks, because it would affect the bills?
Certainly, the way to manage bills in the longer term is to manage peak demand and to encourage more energy efficiency. Those two are essential.
Yep, Barry?
We have to bear in mind we've got other sources of demand that will be coming in the future, like electric vehicles as well, and that will have a big impact on not only managing peak demand but also total energy that's going to need to be supplied to the system. So if we're going to start moving away from oil towards battery electric vehicles, people are going to want to charge those at night so they can drive the next day. There's a lot of things coming in the future that we need to be preparing for, and that's one of them. And so trying to predict what's happening now and say that's the same thing that's going to happen in the future is quite risky.
OK. Muriel, you head up the Solar Panel Industry Group. I just wonder, listening to all of this, I mean, all this money being spent on infrastructure at the moment, is that infrastructure going to be conducive to the kind of changes that people are talking about or not?
Well, I worry that we're spending $30 billion and we might be just trying to shore up a system that was geared up for 19th century power supply, and that we're not really thinking about how quickly that is going to change for us. We've had the mention of electric vehicles, and we've also talked about solar power and the idea that solar power is very expensive. Well, it's actually going down so rapidly that in about 2 years' time, it's going to be about the same price as the electricity that we're buying from our networks. At that stage, we have no way of knowing how consumers are going to react. That's a very different scenario to the one we've had before, where we've had to subsidise solar and so on. When it's cheaper, there could be a very, very high uptake of renewables and solar power in particular, and all their models of how to manage the network and what sort of network they need may not be appropriate unless they're thinking ahead. And certainly our retail market is not going to operate if everyone's generating their own power and not wanting to buy it from the retailers.
OK, we'll get on to more about that in just a moment, more on what the push for renewable energy will mean for consumers. That's next on Insight. Tonight we're talking about electricity prices, why they're going up and how we might better manage our energy needs. Apparently a pretty lively debate going on Facebook about smart meters at the moment. Divided, which is interesting, people divided about it, some people saying they'd love to have one. Zara is saying she prefers to call herself an ostrich, she likes comforts. So that's the kind of difference of opinion we're getting about that. Andrew Reeves, will the shift to renewables, which we were talking about before the break, affect prices?
If we look at the impact of renewables on the network, there's probably two issues. One is longer term and the extent to which there may be wind generation in the more remote areas would need some extension to the transmission grid. But that's probably more the longer term. In the short term, though, it does seem that the grid is probably sufficiently robust, and in most cases there's enough capacity there to deal with renewables without a big impact on network costs.
OK, so the price impacts, just to go back to where we started, are coming mostly from the infrastructure. I mean, what about things like the carbon tax and other issues like that? How are they going to impact on prices?
Well, I think last week the Minister Ferguson said that the Treasury model was showing an increase of about 10% in retail prices from 1 July next year.
Mm, OK. And obviously there's compensation packages associated with the carbon tax to offset some of that as well,
that's
yeah?
Right. That's part of the government's
packages. OK, let's get back to renewables, though. Muriel, you were talking about the costs coming down, but at the moment they aren't coming, you know, they're not coming down. They are expensive and they do need, you know, people do need incentives.
Well, solar power is coming down very, very rapidly, and most of the incentives that the state governments have had on offer are now winding down. The federal government's incentives have been reduced quite substantially, and prices are still going down for solar panels. And in some places in Australia, I'd say that you can already generate power at price, if not the same as, then cheaper than the grid electricity that you're buying. So I think people have been taken by surprise. They've gotten used to thinking of solar power as an expensive option, and it no longer is. And it's affordability that's more important to a household, for instance, than is it really expensive? If they can afford $1,000, then that's something they can do.
Do people think it's affordable, solar? I mean, is it? No. You don't think so, Tony?
It's been probably a year or two since I looked, but I've actually spoken to people and heard what it was going to cost to put in solar. And for me, it would take so many years before you got any value back. I just can't see the value of it.
OK, how many other people feel like that? I just want to get a bit of a sounding here. Yep.
I mean, I guess the point there is that these people haven't necessarily looked at solar PV for a couple of years, and solar has come down drastically over that period. Solar PV is more like a
PV
plasma...
PV meaning photovoltaic, meaning
the panels,
that... Let's explain what we're talking about.
Those modules that sit on people's roofs, they've come down considerably over the last 2 years. They're more like plasma TVs and microprocessors than they are coal-fired generators. It's got a rapid cost curve reduction.
Okay, yes, lady over there.
What I'd like to know is, I live in social housing, in government housing, and what I'd like to know is there an option for government housing to actually have solar if that's what...
Yeah, it's a really good point, and renters too, yeah? Because renters are tied to the system of the person owning the house. How do you work out renewables in that situation, Matthew?
Well, you offer a system where people are encouraged to rent their roof, and perhaps the owner of the building can offer that and pass some benefit over to the tenant. In fact, I've heard of other models around the place that David might know
about. Well, that's
what
David does. You're like a solar real estate agent. Explain what you do.
Yeah, I mean, we focus on the bigger roofs because there's economies of scale for this commercial size systems. And so we rolled out Australia's first roof leasing initiative in the ACT.
So you rent big roofs.
We were upfront that people could either buy the system and get the benefit themselves, or we could just pay them a commercial rent for their roof space. And we installed the first system, launched it, and then were blown away by the demand from businesses. And I mean, these are hard-nosed property developers, national companies.
So how do you make money out of it?
So we make money by generating the electricity. I mean, in the ACT it was based on an incentive and that ended. But now solar, as we discussed, has come down so much over the last, even the last 6 months with the high Australian dollar and with these cost reductions. We're now about to announce a project where we're going to go ahead with in Townsville where we're renting the roof space, where we're owning a solar system, and we're selling electricity back into that shopping centre
but
below the retail rate.
Below the retail rate,
that's,
but you can only
right.
do this in Queensland.
No, we can do this. We can do this in. We're going to go back to all of those customers, that enormous group in the ACT that are incredibly interested, and go back to them and say that there's now an opportunity for them to buy electricity.
Okay, you're a good spruiker for your business. Yeah, Matt.
I just think, from a consumer perspective, it is worth saying consumers love solar, and for that reason, governments love solar, and it has come down in price. It's something that members at Choice ask us about a lot, but I think to make the point, there are a lot of things you would look at doing around the house
probably in some cases before investing in solar PV if your main concern is your energy bill. So things
so to do with energy efficiency.
Exactly right. Things like solar hot water, even things like more efficient appliances, double glazing, ceiling drafts.
Okay, we've got a whole bunch of this on our website. So, and we're running out of time a bit. So I'd direct people to our website because we've got a lot of energy efficiency things that you can check out there about how you can actually bring your bill down in that way. Yeah, gentlemen up here.
I just want to say, in terms of renewables, isn't wind already a large, a fairly large portion of our renewable suite, and actually a lot cheaper than solar technology? And so, while you can't have it on the roof of your house, it's still a fairly large part of renewable technologies that we should be looking at.
Okay, wind. Yeah. Who wants to talk about wind? So, Matthew.
Wind has historically been the cheapest form of renewable energy, and it's installed as a massive energy source around the world. But the thing that's happened is that photovoltaic doesn't have the hard limits of having to build big concrete and steel structures. So what we've seen with the rooftop solar photovoltaic panels, there's no planning involved, they're easy to install, and it's like semiconductors, it's like computers, they just keep coming down in price. And that price reduction David was talking about, in the last 24 months, they've halved in price. So if you got a quote 24 months ago, it's possible you get a quote today and it'll be half the price of what it was 24 months ago.
Okay, David, I want to come back to you because I want you to tell us how solar thermal works compared to solar panels, because solar thermal was what your company was doing, yeah?
Yes, that's right. I mean, photovoltaics or solar panels are things that produce direct current out of the sun, and you can just use that on the spot. It can produce AC like you want through equipment, or it can produce DC for other applications. It doesn't much matter, but it's a simple non-moving parts panel. What we were doing in our company was solar thermal, and that uses heat to big mirrors in the desert kind of thing, heat to achieve very high temperatures to boil water. And run through a steam turbine. That can be more efficient, but it's a lot more complex. And
how viable is that?
Well, we think it's very, very viable, but one of the greatest things, and Matthew would probably want to talk about this a bit more, is that storage is possible very cheaply, relatively cheaply, on solar thermal, but it's very difficult on PV or wind. I should also say that the cost of solar thermal is dropping drastically. We've been seeing costs of over 30 cents a kilowatt hour in Spain for smaller plants of 50 megawatts. We're seeing now costs about half that in the newest plants going up
in
California.
Okay, so storage is difficult with the panels?
Very difficult,
but storage,
yeah, because it has to be
viable.
Batteries, and batteries are quite expensive for the amount they store.
And storage is difficult with wind power as well?
That's right, but if you store in heat, that it's just a big bucket of something hot.
Okay, Matthew?
It's like a thermos. So today in Spain, they've got large baseload solar plants, so solar plants that run 24/7. They run solar power all through the night, solar power around the clock. They're called molten salt power towers. And in fact, there's a plant that I've visited, I think it's on the screen now, called Gema Solar, and it's between Cordoba and Sevilla. And it operates by having a huge central tower surrounded by a sea of mirrors, a field of mirrors, and each of those mirrors is individually tracked to the top of the tower, and huge tanks of salt, which is just like a thermos flask, at the base of the tower, and the heat is moved from one tank in the salt to the other tank, and any time, day or night, you need power, water is run past the salt, which draws the heat out and drives the conventional turbine, the same as a gas, nuclear or coal plant.
And how much of our power needs do you think these sort of things can provide?
We can run our entire grid on a mix of renewables, including the keystones, which are your solar thermal with storage and something like pumped hydro storage.
Okay, now that's being debated. Barry, do you think this is these sorts of things are viable? And would they bring prices down?
I think we're a long way from that right now. That example of the Spanish solar plant, that was 20 megawatts. So you'd need to have 50 of those to equal one large power station. And that's even before you consider its lower capacity factor.
Except that now they're building them at 110 and 150,
sure,
and
but
250 megawatts today under construction.
Okay, just let him finish. Yeah.
If you look at the price of that installation, that equaled the equivalent of $33 billion per gigawatt. So a large coal-fired power station might cost us $3 to $4 billion. For average energy, average power coming from that, $33 billion. So we're talking about very high prices right now. They have a long way to come down. We're not talking about a large-scale commercial operation. And to imagine that Australia could suddenly decide to do this and rapidly move from what we have right now, which is 80% fossil fuels, through to 100% renewables, requires very heroic assumptions that will cost a lot of money.
And so I think that's where the debate... Okay, does that mean we're stuck with the system we have now, David?
The US government is just given very large loan guarantees to very large storage projects in the United States, one using parabolic troughs, which is not like the tower technology that you just saw, another to a tower project. These are close to $1 billion each. These are big businesses now. They are commercial businesses now. And these loan guarantees are about just making sure that they get the lowest interest rate. They're not gifts from the government.
Okay. And I'll point out that they're already half the price, the next ones they're building, than the one Barry pointed out the costs on. So the point about it is you install a small amount of capacity, a small number of plants for a higher price, and the price rapidly comes down, and you install lots of plants at a lower price. The simple fact is...
But it's still a lot more expensive than what we've
got now.
Within
2 years, the global spend on renewable energy will outpace all other sources, all fossil fuels, all nuclear. It outpaces everything within 2 years, and that's according to Bloomberg New Energy Finance.
OK, Chris, what did you want to say?
Yeah, Jenny, we've started talking about energy efficiency and demand management, then we started talking about renewable energies. These are actually two sides of the same coin. One of the issues that came up is how do you store this variable output from your solar and your wind? If we're clever about how we use our energy so that we can match the demand to what is being produced, then we don't need anywhere near as much storage. That's, what we did with off-peak water heating on a massive scale. We need to be just as smart when it comes to the new technologies. The synergies between energy efficiency, demand management and renewable energy are enormous, and they'll become more important as we move to electric vehicles. Mm. So we need to bring the whole picture together.
Okay, but how do you...
Incorporating wind with solar has very, very many beneficial effects on a continental scale or a large country scale as well. Mm. That should
but
be
we're
also
talking here about massive investments, aren't we, to get to the point where any of this could happen.
But
yes?
It's
going to cost a lot of money, and isn't that going to drive prices up?
Business as usual is a massive amount of money. $45 billion is being spent just in our networks over the current five-year period. We need to make decisions that are going to last, rather than us being in a position where we regret them in future because we've backed the wrong horse.
Okay, Roland, what do you think? You had your hand up.
I don't want to be a spoil sport, and I don't want to speak particularly against renewable energy. If we can get it to work, it's fantastic.
But it does
the issue, the
it
issue is...
Today.
Okay, let him finish, Matthew. I know you're an enthusiast, but let him talk.
The issue is here also about cost. Now, I mean, this program's about rising electricity prices. One of the main reasons why prices are going up, aside from the network pricing issue that we discussed earlier, is renewables. If you look at New South Wales, it was about a 17.3%, I think, average increase in retail prices on the 1st of July this year. 9% of that was due to network charges. 6%, which is about a third, was due to renewable energy subsidies. So one thing people have to understand, if they want to pay the price, that's fine, but one thing they have to understand is, you know, the wind might be free, the sun might be free, but certainly there is a cost associated to renewable energy, and it does increase your electricity bill.
Okay, whatever we do, are high prices inevitable, or prices that we consider high? I mean, that's the other question, I suppose, is whether, you know, what do you think, Muriel?
Well, I think that we're missing the point that the renewables are going down so fast, whereas traditional sources are established technologies and their costs are not going down. The more renewables we have in our grid, the less we will be exposed to the carbon prices that are coming, and the more we are, I guess, shielded from higher prices in future, because you're investing, hedging your bets against other things going up in future. So the investments that governments have chosen to make by supporting renewables are a very good investment for Australian consumers in the long term.
OK, George, what do you think is the best way of keeping prices down? And what contribution can you make to that in your role?
Well, I think smart grids will make a contribution over time, particularly with electric vehicles and the storage potential that electric vehicles have. But I think if we're talking the short term, 3 to 5 years, I don't think any of these technologies are really going to help keep prices down. They're very expensive, and in the foreseeable future, to keep electricity affordable, I don't think these technologies are going to
be. Okay, so how are you going to keep it affordable?
Well, I think the you do need to manage peak demand. You need to make the grids more efficient, and I think managing energy, like energy use, empowering consumers to manage their, give them more information to enable them to to manage their demand more effectively. I think that's the key in the short term.
OK, Matthew, just quickly.
Modelling from Europe has shown that when you use a feed-in tariff to wedge renewables artificially into electricity grids, it depresses the base black power price and peak power price, and it actually pays itself off. So it's the net cost to consumers is actually zero. So even though it's a feed-in tariff funding component on the price stack, which Roman alerted us to, what he's not mentioning is that you depress the price of the wholesale electricity and that's then passed through to consumers. It's just like if you have a bumper year of wheat crop, you pay less for bread at the bakery, or if you have a drought, you pay more. So when you're having feeding tariff for lots of photovoltaic on the grid, it's like having a bumper year of wheat. You've got a bumper year of electrons and the price goes down and the consumers are the winner.
Okay.
So renewables are cheaper for consumers.
All right, just really quickly, Andrew, are we going to have to get used to these price increases? Are they going to be with us for quite a long time?
Well, look, there's nothing to indicate that prices are likely to be coming down in the medium term. All of these options of renewables are expensive. The technology is expensive. Even moving into demand management and energy efficiency requires investment from consumers. So I think it is unfortunate, but we do have to face an era of rising energy costs.
All right. If you want to find out how to lower your bill, go to our website. We've got a lot of tips on how you can lower your electricity bill and energy efficiency methods. And if you want to keep talking to our guests, Chris Dunstan, Barry Brook and Matthew Wright, you can on our live chat. If you're in the eastern states, just hop onto our website and click on the link. Thank you all very much for joining us. Don't forget our Facebook page as well. Do keep talking about this and other topics through the week. Coming up next week...
I think if I was in Vietnam, I would probably eat dog.
No, I wouldn't eat a dog, per se, because we have such a sort of emotional connection with that type of animal.
I've never eaten monkey before, but I've eaten things like fruit bat.
I would eat monkey. I would probably draw the line on, and I think it might be mythical, but eating monkey brains, perhaps, in an inhumane and unnecessary way, because they do supposedly eat this while it's alive.
Eating meat, what's okay, what isn't, and why. Don't miss it till next week. Good night.
Join the Inside audience, register by calling 0419 799 137 or just follow the link on our website.